What will the cuts in public spending decreed by the government do to us? Supposing, though, some of the people who ought to be paying taxes so the cuts aren't so bad aren't actually doing so.
And so today, I can tell you about a new approach we're calling Help to Work.
Work brings freedom.
For the first time, all long-term unemployed people who are capable of work will be required to do something in return for their benefits and to help them find work. They will do useful work, putting something back into their community, making meals for the elderly, clearing up litter, working for a local charity. Others will be made to attend the job centre every working day. And for those with underlying problems like drug addiction and illiteracy, there will be an intensive regime of support. No one will be ignored or left without help. But no one will get something for nothing. Help to work and in return work for the dole. Because a fair welfare system is fair to those who need it and fair to those who pay for it too.
Arbeit macht frei. Work brings freedom.
Work sets you free.
Help to work.
Arbeit macht frei.
I do actually hope that the masters of war die tomorrow.
Steve Baker.
Mr. Speaker, the quality and quantity of welfare produced by the state has not been good enough for a very long time.
We hail, we hail, in the sure's pay, not the poor. Welcome, workers of Nazi-land. What a glorious privilege is yours to be a Nazi. To work 48 hours a day for the poor. Then the Fuhrer says, we never will be slaves. We heil, heil, but still we work like slaves. While the Fuhrer brags and lies and rants and raves, we heil, heil, and work into our graves. Heil Hitler!
Heil Hitler!
Agenda 21. Agenda 21.
A welly clad Prince of Wales.
Has the Environment Agency done enough, sir?
Straight into local politics, but he couldn't resist a response.
You might very well think so. I couldn't possibly comment.
But comment he did, earlier in a village hall, amidst the acres of land which have been submerged in floodwaters for weeks now. And what he said, no doubt, picked up by a nearby camera crew, will resonate loudly in these parts.
What the frack is Mickey Mouse up to in Ohio? See, last month, Radio Disney employees traveled to 26 schools and science centers across the state promoting a program called Rockin' in Ohio. Sounds innocent enough, right? Well, turns out this initiative was entirely funded by none other than the Ohio Oil and Gas Energy Education Program, which in turn gets its money from, you guessed it, oil and gas companies. During the demonstration, the kids were shown interactive presentations about gas pipelines and encouraged to spread the message about the industry. Now, I'm just guessing here, but I doubt these kids were also taught that infertility and cancer-causing chemicals have been found in fracking water supplies, and that the practice is responsible for artificial earthquakes in Youngstown, Ohio. Unsurprisingly, the fracking indoctrination of Ohio's youth isn't sitting too well with environmental activists. In fact, one online petition urging Disney's CEO to shut down this program has already gathered over 80,000 signatures. So if you think the Magic Kingdom and oil belong together as well as water and oil, then let's break.
David Cameron visited an onshore oil drilling site on the Nottinghamshire-Lincolnshire border to promote his shale gas offer to councils. Environmentalists say fracking would be a very different, much riskier operation than this. David Cameron says it's an opportunity the country cannot afford to pass up.
We're saying as soon as a well is dug, the local community should get £100,000. They should get 1% of the revenues over the life of that well. That could be up to £10 million per well. And today we're announcing that the local council should keep 100% of the business rates. That could be £2 million, £3 million every year.
I would think the majority might be worried. I think they think about foundations of houses and the water table. I worry about the water table and the chemicals that are in the water, and a lot of water's pumped down along with sand, and it's really a worry.
And that's why we're saying, look, you're not going to be able to do nothing in return for your benefits anymore. You're going to have to either turn up at the job centre every day, or you're going to have to undertake community work, or you're going to have to get help for some underlying problem you might have, like a drug addiction or illiteracy. We're saying, you know, we're not going to leave behind anymore a generation on long-term unemployment. We're going to do everything we can to help them into work.
Arbeit macht frei. Work brings freedom.
Help to work.
So this is what we want to see. Everyone under 25.
Guest.
And the whole agenda is to create a one world government where everybody has an RFID chip implanted in them. All money is to be in those chips. Right, there'll be no more cash. And this is giving me straight from Rockefeller himself. This is what they want to accomplish. And all money will be in your chips. And if you're like me or you, and you're protesting what they're doing, they can just turn off your chip. And you have nothing. You can't buy food. You can't do anything. It's total control of the people.
And that chip's connected to a database that has your purchasing records, what you do.
Everything. Everything is in there. You know? And so they want a one world government. Controlled by them, everybody being chipped, all your money in those chips, and they control the chips, and they control people, and you become a slave, you become a serf to these people. That's their goal, that's their intentions.
Help to work.
A doctor employed by the company which assesses people for disability benefits has strongly criticised its methods as unfair. In an interview with the BBC, Greg Wood says he felt compelled to speak out after he saw what he claims was medical knowledge being twisted against people. The company, Atos, denies the allegations, as our correspondent Sophie Hutchinson reports.
Well, these assessments need to be done independently, impartially, considering all the evidence and with proper use of medical knowledge, and that's just not happening at the moment. Pressure is being put on healthcare professionals to, in many cases, come up with a particular outcome, really regardless of the facts of the case.
Dr. Wood alleges the assessments for the employment and support allowance are unfair and unethical. He claims he was instructed to change reports. He says that medical knowledge is twisted, and he says the system is skewed against the claimant. Dr. Wood also claims the system is failing some of the most vulnerable who are being asked to attend assessments. He saw many distressing examples.
Someone with motor neurone disease, which again, progressive neurological condition, who I actually put in the terminal illness group because he was. You should not have come for a face-to-face assessment.
What is so upsetting about meeting somebody?
Because it's cruel.
Abolish this cruel, heartless monster called Atos. Get rid of it.
Prime Minister.
For purpose.
The Prime Minister.
Hello, nice to see you all.
Where's Catherine? Somebody said I should have a word with her this afternoon.
They call you Dinky, yes? Do they?
Buckingham Palace has said that the Queen is aware of reports that two of her cousins have been kept secretly in a mental hospital, but added that it was a matter for the Bowes Lyon family. Today, the family said that entries in Burke's peerage showing the two women had died many years ago were the result of vagueness and not a cover-up.
The forbidding walls of Royal Ulswood Mental Hospital. A sad and until now secret home for five female cousins of Her Majesty the Queen.
In 1987, when journalists uncovered the story of Catherine and Nerissa Bowes Lyon, they found a further three members of the family had been admitted to the Royal Ulswood on the same day in 1941. The Fane sisters, Edonia, Etheldreda and Rosemary, were first cousins to the Bowes Lyons on their mother's side.
I just feel sorry to think that they had so many in that family. If you go back and think about this, all this interbreeding which they've done through the years, something has got to go wrong at some time or other, somewhere along the line.
The Fane sisters' records have survived and show that they too were diagnosed as imbeciles. As the story of the Queen's remaining cousin gained momentum, all eyes turned to the palace.
Well, I think it's a great opportunity for the royal family now to show the general public that mental handicap is not something to be ashamed of, not something to be shunned or afraid of or put away.
There was an opportunity at the time for the royal family, in particularly the Queen Mother, as patron of MenCap, and they did nothing. Why that might have been, one wonders if there's still the hereditary taint around that was there in the early 20th century.
The charity MenCap says that people with learning disabilities are being failed by the NHS, resulting in unrecognised pain, delays in treatment, and even orders not to resuscitate being applied without family consent. One couple with two disabled daughters believe their younger child, Tina, died unnecessarily in 2009. They say she wasn't given the right treatment by her GP or the hospital because of her learning disabilities. The case has been referred to the Health Ombudsman.
I'm more valuable dead than alive.
Agenda 21. Agenda 21.